But that was me. And of course, wouldn't start. But this kind of theme here of Mary with the alabaster box, I think is and should be our closing theme for our spiritual year that ends at the end of June. I think it gives us focus even more on his heart. I think that in soaking in preparation, we used the example of Esther when we began, and in that example, Esther was seeking to be softened by the soaking of the oils, seeking to be prepared, to prepare herself for being a bride for the king, for and in those parts, a whole lot of the focus can be on us, because we're shooting for something. And I think that's okay in the early going. I think that's actually has a certain amount of necessity as long as our hearts are pointed in the right direction. And that this quote unquote soaking in the word is with an end that is different than soaking in the word or getting soft or just being a soft Christian or just being open more to the Lord or to all those things, which every Christian should do anyway. And I think that thing, if we get too much into our preparations for him, we're not really mindful of him. And it is my belief that really the only true preparation that will really make any difference at all is to have your heart totally given to the Lord for a period of time, totally given in a concerted manner. And I want to read this story again. It's in Mark 14, and I'll probably share a little bit of the things that I shared in the conference in Ireland, and I'll probably share a few things that I shared last Thursday night. But all of it are things that are on my heart, and I believe on the heart of the Holy Spirit, who desires to draw us deeper into what the the wrap up, I guess, is. This is Mark 14. Starting at verse 3. Excuse me. And being in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat eating, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very precious. She broke the box and poured the ointment on his head. And in some of the other gospels where it gives this story, it says that he poured it upon her on his feet, at which I think both took place. And the first thing to notice in that verse is that they were in Bethany, and this woman is Mary of Bethany, and it says that in John, I think 12, maybe the first couple of verses there, it identifies her as the sister of Martha. And the sister of Lazarus. And that she was the one who did this. And their home was in Bethany. And if you know anything about the scriptures on that front, then you know that Jesus resorted to Bethany, which was really, it was just outside of Jerusalem. I mean, it really wasn't far at all. It was pretty close. But Jesus resorted there a lot and was in their home a fair amount of time. And I think that Jesus found solace, not the little boy, but rest and peace. And because if Solace was there. I'm freaked out because he's probably just a kid. Anyway. And there's, you get the impression that there was something that this family drew out of him. You get the impression that they took him in, Jesus. They took Jesus in, which is pretty cool. Because it's not that, it's, you know, everybody took Jesus in as, you know, their Savior or the Messiah or whatever as they walk. You know, oh, yes, Jesus, you know, yeah. You know, and the triumphal entry that had actually happened before this event right here. So there's a lot of people shouting and praising and, you know, and we love you and you're the one and all that kind of stuff. But you get the impression that, and it doesn't make them better, but you get the impression that this family just felt that there was something, you know, whether it was expressed by Martha in, I want to take you in and I want to feed you and I want you in our home and, you know, this sort of thing, to Mary, who sat at his feet, which is an event that happened way before this. Between that event and this one, I can show you in the scriptures that Jesus went to a whole lot of different cities and a whole lot of things. So this event that happened in Bethany at their house was a situation of Jesus being there, and he was invited in, and we don't know how many days he was there, but we know that Martha was cooking, and that particular time doesn't really mention Lazarus, but it does mention this Mary. And this Mary is at his feet at that time, which is, again, before this event. But there's something transpiring here, and there's something transpiring there. There is a flow before this happened, when Mary was at his feet and Martha was cooking, where Jesus was being the broken vessel, was being the open vessel, and was pouring into her. He was pouring that which is in his heart to her. And the story there really, it doesn't mention anybody else. Doesn't mention the disciples are hanging out, or doesn't mention that anybody else is listening or whatever. It does mention that Martha doesn't seem to be really aware of what's taking place between Jesus and Mary at that time, and obviously has no clue where that's going to go in the future here, where we've just started reading. Only that that Mary seems to be out of whack with the ministry. The ministry here is we're trying to take care of Jesus, which if you put these things in words, they sound just like what Mary was trying to do. It does. Sounds just like that. And Scott and I and Jim and some of the guys, when we were having the men's meeting, we discussed this. We were reading out of Watchman Nee's book on Why This Waste, and there was a phrase in that book, or a sentence in that book, and I should have brought it, but it said something like, you know, we are, and it was, you know, talking about this event here, but it said we should be poured out to Jesus, and we should love Jesus supremely, and the wording was just powerful. And I said to the guys, I said, well, you know, picture this scenario before this happened, where Mary is at his feet and she's breaking the alabaster box, and Jesus is responding like, you know, whatever else is going on, this is memorial ministry. This ministry right here is eternal, and it's gonna go throughout all generations forever. All right. So before this event, they're walking to this home in Bethany, and Jesus just decides. And this is, I'm making this part of the story up here. Jesus just says, you won't find it in your Bible. Jesus just decides just before he gets here, you know, we're a little bit tired, let's rest. Peter, why don't you share the word with the fellas? And Peter goes, we need to be poured out. We need to be given. Da 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 da. Okay, and they're saying all of that, and every one of us have heard that on some level before, and most of us think that that's what we are doing, including the 12 who, as we shall read, are indignant and see no difference. In fact, they don't even see this as memorial ministry. They see this as a waste. They see the depth of someone who would recognize, and that's, we'll get into that in just a second, recognize Jesus for who he is and honor that, is different than these fellows, these 12 disciples that are following Jesus and just ask him, ask Peter, are you, you know, Lord, we have given up all. We have poured out all. We constantly serve. We follow you. We do everything you ask. Da 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 da. And so Peter would have said all of that and said, we need to be this way, and then walked into this situation and says, what's this waste going on here? What, you know, not even be able to recognize the thing that touches Jesus the heart the most. Now, that doesn't say that they're not following Jesus. Obviously, these are the 12 disciples. But they've missed something. They have missed something that's important to Jesus. All right, now that right there, that should get our attention. They have missed something that's important to Jesus. And in fact, it doesn't sound like it's just important. It sounds like this is some sort of a mammoth thing that has not really taken place before. With all of the stuff that's happened up to this point, there is a reaction from Jesus, and it's sort of a backlash against their reaction. Okay, but let me finish this verse. There came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment. This is still verse 3 in Mark 14. Very precious. And she broke the box, poured the ointment on, basically on Jesus, his head, his feet. Now, she has come based on something that happened prior to this. And what happened prior to this was a good long while before. Jesus wasn't in Simon the leper's house in Bethany. Jesus was in Bethany at Lazarus and Martha's and Mary's house. And she is caught up in a pouring out that is taking place. That nobody, the words are not recorded. Nobody knows what's said. And God, Jesus, however deep this touched him, made sure it wouldn't put in the scriptures so that we wouldn't just pick it up and say, I got it because I can say these words. But I don't know, you've experienced this before. Have you ever experienced that, like, some people you get around them and the word just flows out of you, and you get around other people and you want to share and it's just like, you know, they don't pull the word out of you. You can't, there's no explanation for it. I mean, there really isn't. It's like, I don't know why, but when I get around you, I just, all I want to do is share, and we share, and it just flows. And when I get around you, it just, nothing, you know. And I mean, I've done that, and I've felt bad, and I go, what's wrong with me? But you know, sometimes, like with this case with Jesus, I think there's just people that are open. They're so hungry for what's in you of Jesus that they're just drawing it out, and it just flows. And you know, and I don't know, but I think that's what's going on right here. I think that there's no explanation. There's something in her, and Jesus is just pouring. But he's not just sharing the Sermon on the Mount. are the, you understand, all the other sermons. This isn't a sermon. This isn't, you know, love your enemies. Something is transpiring where there is an opening as if he were an alabaster box. And he's opening his heart in ways that he refuses to put in the scriptures for us to discover by just being a Christian and reading. He left out. He intentionally left it out. And I'm glad that he did. So, she's breaking this and she's pouring it on Jesus' feet and his head. And then verse 4, and there were some that had indignation within themselves. And some of the other accounts says the disciples did, the disciples. And there were some who had indignation within themselves and said, why was this waste of the ointment made? Why was this waste of the ointment made? For it might have been sold for more than 300 denarii and have been given to the poor. And they murmured against her. All right. So this isn't just a lack of recognition of ministry. This is an attack on something that Jesus is going to say, leave her alone. He's going to express that, you know, this thing's going everywhere for all time. This is important to me. And then he also adds in these little words, she did this for my burial. Okay. So, the disciples, they love Jesus. Ask them if they're poured out. Yes. Ask them if they haven't sat at Jesus' feet before. Yes. Ask them if they don't believe that they're totally committed. Yes. Ask them if they know at all what's going on here. And they would say, yes, waste is going on here. Something that is just not of God. Why? Because we're trying to reach people. Jesus has always talked to us and said, okay, you 70, go into all the cities. And, you know, and that happened in between this and the story where Mary was sitting there at his feet with Martha cooking. Go into all the cities and preach and do miracles and heal and all this kind of stuff. You know, we need money. Don't you, you know, they could even say this. Don't you realize that the poor we have with us? And there seems to be no end of it, which is basically what Jesus was saying. There seems to be no end. There's always need. There, you know, every, it's like a nest of a billion baby birds going, feed me, keep, keep, keep. You know, the poor you have with you, always. And they're saying, we have them here always. This isn't going to end. This ministry is not going to end. We need all the resources for this. And up until this point, Jesus probably wouldn't have said anything, because I don't think he'd encountered anything like this. But when she was back in the house with Martha and at his feet, and Jesus was pouring this way, she wasn't pouring that way yet, Jesus was pouring this way, there had to be things that were communicated that weren't doctrinal. They weren't doctrinal. These were things of Jesus' heart. And to discover things of Jesus' heart is actually to discover him. And Jesus just didn't, apparently just didn't open that up to just everybody. You know, just didn't do that. And so there's this flow that is happening, and the only information we have on what that was is given to us in this story right here with the alabaster box. This is happening 2 days before Jesus is dead. 2 days. You say, well, in John it says 6 days. Well, we can discuss that. I'll show you. But the other two say 2 days. And the disciples, do they know what's about to happen? Do they know the cross? I was reading one place and it says, and Jesus said to them, this is right in this area, and Jesus said to them, you know, the Son of Man must go to Jerusalem and must die and must be killed and badly treated, evilly treated, whatever words it uses, but then he shall rise on the third day. And it says immediately after that, and the disciples understood none of these things, he said. None. It's like, what was that? I don't know. You know how Jesus is so deep and spiritual. I'm sure it'll get into us in about a week too late. They don't know. They have no clue of Lamb that they've been following. Anybody ever read the book of Revelation where it describes the followers of Jesus as the followers of the Lamb? They have no clue of being a follower. So what is their concept of following Jesus? What is it? Ministry, yeah. And not memorial ministry, but what I use the word compassionate ministry, which is having compassion on the poor or the sick or the needy or the lost or that sort of thing, which I don't deprecate at all. I don't put down at all. And Jesus, in that sense, didn't put down their ministry. He just said, your ministry, let her alone. Really, it was a contrast of ministries in a very real sense, you know. Do what you know to do, because he didn't say, well, stop doing that. He didn't say that. He said, let her alone. So, but Jesus describes whatever's happening here, whatever the deal is, Jesus attributes to her a tiny bit of information. That she's got more than a tiny bit, but he only lets a little bit slip out. Just a little bit. She hath done this for my burial. And it implies that she knows what she's doing. Because it could have been worded different, you know. Well, she's ignorant as a stump, but this, I'm going to count this for my burial because I know I'm dying. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it could be something like that, but, you know, thank God Jesus doesn't talk like J.W. But anyway. Or me. I know. I'm as bad on other fronts. Worse, actually, in a whole lot of ways. Jesus is attributing something to her that he considers really big. In 2 days, I will be dead. And she's giving me something right here to take into my grave with me that I can carry with me forever. She's given me something right here. You say, yeah, that oil is pretty expensive, that ointment. She gave you something really costly. God, there's the problem right there. That is the problem, is we go by what we see. We go by what we read, and we don't delve into, and I say we don't. You probably do more than I do, but I'm just, it's my place to say that we don't really say, Lord, how shall I see this unless you open my eyes? I am blind. I am blind to any meaning anywhere in the scriptures. I'm a blind man, and I admit that, and I keep that ever in the forefront, that I don't have a clue until you open my eyes to each and every verse in scripture, and I live as a blind man. We go, I see, and I'm going to add this little piece to this, and you know, pretty soon I'm going to know everything. And we don't. We don't. So the disciples are sitting there, or we're reading the account. Maybe that's a better way of putting it. We're reading the account, and we go, oh, my God. Oh, my God. She's, you know, I want Memorial Ministry. So I'm going to check this woman out and see what she does and what she says, and she doesn't say anything. Woo! This is great, because Jesus is shutting off all the carnal Christians. Not that there's any in here, but, you know. Yeah, all the other ones, uh-huh. The ones that are like from here out. I'm just teasing. I'm teasing. But the whole deal is that we're looking at the wrong person.
Yes.
Amen.
We are looking at her and we're going, I'm going to get this. Yep. And I really, you know, and you know, I hate to use this as an example. But, you know, if Jesus didn't have feet, we'd be out of luck. But it does signify something, doesn't it?
Yes.
It does. And if you can see her heart in relationship to this, that's good. But a lot of times we don't see her heart, but we're trying to discover her heart. But what we see is what she's doing. And we go, okay, well, first of all, she took something very, very costly to her. Hasn't anybody here in coming to Jesus, did you give up anything you felt like was really, really important or da-da-da-da? I know you gave up that CD that you loved, or, you know, or several of them, and, you know, and you just poured it out on Jesus' feet. Jesus goes, I don't use CDs, so, you know. Keep it, you know. You know, and we're just so, so proud of ourselves, you know, which is the exact opposite of the spirit of what's going on there. You know, it's like, I really did something for Jesus. Yes! You know, I feel so good. And Jesus is going, well, that's good. I'm glad it's all about you, you know. Anyway, so, you know, there's this focus, and our focus, and that's why we can't get in on it when Martha's cooking and this thing's going on. We can't get on it, in on it, because most of the time in that story, since it doesn't tell us anything Jesus said, and Mary never says anything, nothing. She gives us nothing. Not in these stories. I think, you know, there is a interim story that happened just before this where she did speak. It's another story. There's only three stories where she's in. And that's when Lazarus died. And Jesus is far away. The message comes from them and says, your friend is sick. The one whom you love is sick. And Jesus says, well, okay. Turns to his disciples and they say, well, let's pack up and go. And he goes, no, let's just wait a few days. Let's just wait. And the disciples, if you read the story, they go back and forth, you know. They don't even know it. Jesus says he's asleep. And they go, well, if he's asleep, he's okay. You know, it's like talking to me, you know, idiots, me. It's like, you know, what? And, okay, he's dead. You know. I mean, if they can't get that, they're not going to get Mary and Bethany. You know? So So Jesus says, this sickness is not unto death. Well, he's dead. Anybody ever had somebody pray over somebody else and you were there and they prayed, oh, Lord, or tell them, they prophesied to you, this sickness is not unto death. Well, don't do that over me because Lazarus died. But Jesus knew that he'd be raised and would, you know, but that's a different story, see. So Jesus waits around, he hangs around a good week, I would assume, because he seemed like he was pretty far away with his disciples, and when he got there, Lazarus had already been dead 4 days. So we're talking a good week, possibly. Martha meets him before he even gets to Bethany. He's still not even in Bethany. Guess she heard he's coming. You know, and Martha's ready to do something, you know. Let's get this thing fixed. She's going, you know, if you'd have been here, he'd have been raised, and you know. Jesus says something about resurrection, and she goes, well, you know, I believe in resurrection. I know he'll be raised in the last days. I still got faith, but, you know, what about now? Jesus says, now I'm the resurrection and the life. And he really comes to be the I am there. He wants to communicate something that's hard to communicate in words. And so Martha goes to Mary, she goes into Bethany, she gets Mary, and Mary's in there weeping, and she's got all these people around there that are weeping too. And Martha comes up and says, the Master calleth for thee, which Jesus didn't call for her. So she was just waiting on the Lord. You know, she wasn't doing anything. She's just waiting. And she didn't want to move until Jesus moved her. So Martha says, the Lord calleth for thee. And I think all the words she says is, Lord, if you'd have been here, he wouldn't have died. And Jesus wept. That's where the scripture is. Jesus wept. And Jesus wept. The subject is death. The subject is just shortly after that, this story about the alabaster box happens, and the subject is death. Anybody see a correlation where maybe Mary messed up or didn't see Jesus, didn't grasp this whole thing, and finally got it, and she comes in broken and crying, and oh my God, I heard your heart and I heard what was in you, and I thought I had it, and I, you know, but I don't know how to apply it in circumstances, but there is this thing that had moved me. But what is worse than failing? Jesus weeping. Jesus weeping. And the people go, oh, how he loved Lazarus. Well, if that were the case, he would have, you know, hurried up the thing and got there and made sure he didn't die. Right? I mean, you know, he's not going, oh my God, he died. Dang it, I didn't know that. No, he knew exactly what was going to happen. He came as the resurrection and the life. No, his weeping came immediately when Mary opened her mouth and knew nothing about death and resurrection. She'd been poured into, and Jesus opened his heart. And Jesus gave of himself, and he meant it, and it was all real. And the next time he sees her, she should have been with him where he's at, and it's just about losing a brother. She lost a brother. And it doesn't matter if she was blaming Jesus or not. It doesn't matter, you know, whether if she was blaming him or just going, you know, if you'd have been here. The point is, after all of that and after me opening my heart, you really don't know me yet. And this is the key. You don't know me. You think I am just what they think, a healer, someone who does a miracle, someone who feeds everybody, compassionate ministry. You think that's what I am. Now, he does that, amen? He does that. We do that. We believe in that. But they think that's what it's about because they don't know anything about the cross. Nothing about the cross, which happens to be the biggest, explosion of what the reality of God is that was ever given to man. And will forever be the symbol of it, Lamb slain on the throne. They don't know anything about that. They do know Jesus in the sense of they love Jesus. They serve Jesus. They've given up everything. It's everything that you could say about this woman they have done, except they haven't done what this woman did. They don't know this ministry, this reality. They don't know it. And she needed to be kickstarted. Kick, then started. She needed to see something in relationship to a contrast of what she thought she had to what is in him and go and realize, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And then the tears. And then the tears, his tears, Jesus' tears.
That's right.
How many times you see that going on?
That's right.
And why would this woman's comment, it wasn't just the comment. It's never just the comment or the action. She broke this and she poured it. It's never just the actions. It's never just the deeds. It is not. It is not. It is not. It's the heart, and it's the heart that is toward him. You see, and I'm sure these disciples who are, like it says in the verse 5, and they murmured against her, they're only murmuring because they're trying to do something for Jesus. But didn't say, and they, said, you shouldn't do that, give us the money. So they murmured. They murmured. Because they're entering into a this time period. It's like walking into this time tunnel that is filled with eternity, and they're just, hey, we could have used that, And she's just wasting stuff. If she really, really, really understood this, she would have been with us. But no, she's just trying to make a big display, which clearly she wasn't, because she wasn't focused on anything but Jesus. When she poured that out on him, and I said this to the guys when we were in Ireland, we all focus on the alabaster box being broken and poured out, but to her, it was Jesus that was the sweet savor. This is just an act. This, she did what she could. That's what the scripture says. She did, she's I want to say it like this. She's back.
Yes, that's right.
She's back.
Amen.
With Jesus and with Jesus' heart. And she's focused. She's not pulled anymore. She's focused, and this is it. This is it. You know, somebody could have said, you know, and in a sense, the disciples did say that. This ministry, this that we're doing, what I'm doing is important. It is really important. Okay, good. There is a, where do I have that? I got a scripture. I was going to read you some notes here too, but my thing won't open. I've never had this not open. The Lord doesn't want you to hear it. It's sealed. I think it is. I'm with him. I don't care. I really am. I am not going to push. But I will tell you from the scripture, there's this guy, and Jesus is sharing and teaching and stuff, and so, you know, you get the impression they raised hands because the way, you know, the guy raised his hands, and he was a lawyer, it says in Matthew 22. God, this is good stuff, but I probably... Okay, so this lawyer says, he says, what's the greatest commandment? And he's, you know, what's the first commandment? And he's meaning, what's the greatest commandment? Jesus, what's the greatest commandment? Okay, is it don't kill, don't steal? Don't commit adultery. Don't do this. Don't do that. Don't. That's what we think Jesus is always after. Don't do this. Don't do that. He wants your heart. Don't do this. I won't give you my heart, but I'll quit doing that. No.
Yes.
Give me your heart. And that's what he was getting from her. And that's why it hurt when he lost it. And that's why he rejoiced when he gained it. I am taking this into my burial. Hallelujah.
Yes.
What's the greatest? What, in fact, I think in here it says, what is the first commandment? And Jesus says, the first and greatest commandment is,
yes.
Thou shalt love. I love my brother and my sister. And I love Jesus. We all love Jesus. The disciples, if you ask them while she's pouring this out, do you guys love Jesus? You love him? They would go, yeah. That, why do you think we serve him the way we do? Why do you think we left our nets? Why do you think we joined New Creation Fellowship or Acts Bible School? Because we love him. But at that event, there is a big contrast between the first commandment and the second. At that event.
Yes.
There is. There's a difference between loving Jesus and, okay, let's see if I can do this. Probably get in trouble with this then. Are you okay with that? Yeah, he's okay with that. Okay, let's say that you're married. Do you love your wife? Oh yeah, I love my wife. Well, do you show it? Yeah, I work my job. I'm a good provider. That's the American way, isn't it? That's how you show, I mean, I'm just talking about in general. That's how men show that they love their wife and their kids. It is. It is a very common thing, and it's good, thank God. For, I mean, at least that, you know. Because if you don't have that, you really got nothing, man, you know. You're living in a van down by the river. Anyway. But there's never any affection. There's never, you know, and I know that, you know, I know. Being a counselor and having counseled many a man in that office and the offices that I've had in the other locations, there is a general thing. I've had many guys come into me and they go, oh, my wife, this and that, and, you know, she wants me to be more whatever and da, da, da. And he says, I've had several say this, well, when I get out of this meeting, because she knows I'm having counseling with the pastor, I'm going to go buy her some flowers and chocolates. And I said, that's the last thing you need to do right now. That is the last thing. Don't do it. And one of them went and did it. And it was bad. You think that this, you know, just throw some stuff in my direction and think, everything's wonderful, you know. You know? Have you ever picked a flower, even a dandelion or something, and just given it, you know, and said, here, I'm thinking of you. Or what? I can't even put it all into words, because, see, it has to come from the heart, and if it doesn't come from the heart, it's useless. It's useless, it's useless. And you say, no, it's not. I spent good money on that. See? You're useless. Because it's not on that basis. Well, guess what? Jesus feels the same way. And so the disciples can serve and serve and serve and serve and serve, but there has to come a day where the gospel is carried in this spirit. Where everywhere you go, there's the fragrance of Christ. Not just if you're a little broken thing. That could be the second commandment. And love your neighbor as yourself. And I'm doing this for Jesus. And I'm breaking the expensive stuff for them or whatever, you know. But rather, you're carrying that, as it were, the brokenness of Christ, because he has communicated his heart to you. And again, in the story of Lazarus, when he died, you began to see, oh, it means something to him deeply. And no one will really know. They don't. And they don't. Jesus wept. Oh, how he loved Lazarus. A swing and a miss. Totally devoid of understanding his heart or what are the important things. Jesus said the first and the greatest. And I'm seeing this happening between the Father and Jesus there. See, they say, Jesus, to you, see, not theologically or as God tell us, what's the greatest commandment? As a master teacher, Jesus, to you, what's the greatest? He goes, to me, to love him with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my strength and all my mind, to do that. And, you know, Jesus said, do that in the second one. In other words, let that flow out of you to them and let that be the source and the fountainhead that from which everything springs. All the law is fulfilled in that. You know, it is. It is fulfilled in that. So that's Jesus speaking there. And that's, see, again, that's not the master teacher. That's his heart. That's how he feels about the Father. Not by commandment, but by the way it's been in eternity. God is love. God is selfless. God thinks of the other, vaunteth not himself, you know, all of the things that we apply. Well, God is love. So all of that is how he is. So we go, oh, well, if God is love and that is how he is, then I'm going to be selfless. How's that working for you? That same God, that same nature, that same Jesus has to be in us. There has to be a joining. There has to be a wedding, as it were. There has to be a union. And, you know, I was thinking about this a couple of days ago. I was thinking about the difference between, because somebody said to me, yeah, what's the importance of the covenant? And it just dawned on me, there's two different kinds of covenant. There's a marriage covenant, and there's a business covenant. Some of you know, like a business covenant. It's a contract. And usually in contracts and business things, it is, you do this, and I'll do this. It's an agreement, you know. I'll give you this amount of money, you give me this house or something. You see what I mean? But there's a contractual agreement that we will do what this says. But in a true marriage covenant, because you can't go by, this church is amazing with how long everybody has stayed together with their spouses. You know, it really is. It's just amazing. But there's a true covenant that is not just, I wrote my own vows. And if you wrote your own vows, I'm not going against that. I'm just saying that better come from a marriage covenant, which is of the heart, where there is a commitment not based on what's written anywhere. Like, you know, most weddings, they read 1 Corinthians 13, you know. Love and da-da-da-da, and they go through the whole thing, and they're both going, oh, yeah, amen. And they look at one another, they go, oh, yes. And God's just going, I'll slap you. Not really, he's not. That's just, but that's what we're, you know, and it's all this ooey, gooey, gushy, stewy, and it's not really from the heart. A marriage covenant is actually not on paper, because it's oneness. Two shall be one. It's oneness. It's oneness. It's oneness. It's oneness. It's oneness. And that is the only thing that God honors. That's all. Everything else, we think, oh, this is so important, and that's so important. No, it's only one thing. Love the Lord thy God with all your heart. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about that this woman came into something, and she came into something from his heart, and out of the abundance of his heart, whatever he spoke, and see, that's why I say it's not important. I mean, it is important when it happens to us, but it's not important to communicate it. What's important to know is if Jesus says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh, you know, he could say, well, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh, and we can hear it like this. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh, thinking that he's just talking to us when he's just talking in general. That's the way it is with God. That's the way it's supposed to be with you. Yeah. Jesus is Jewish. He can talk like this. And so he, out of the abundance of his heart, it's pouring. And it's pouring over her. And it's pouring in her. And she's had a period of time to get it together. But then this Lazarus thing happens, quite accidentally, I'm sure. Death. The situation of, you know. And So Jesus comes along and she says one thing out of her mouth that is contrary to him, and it brings him to tears. But that's not the end of the story, is it? That's not the end of the story. We could say, well, this terrible, horrible thing that I've done to you, Jesus, is just unconscionable and unforgivable and da-da-da-da. What if it wasn't first and foremost about forgiveness, but about going back and finding his heart? Amen. What if that was it? What if that was it? And then being with him, which she did. Which she did. And she comes in there, and she's got nothing else on her heart but him. She doesn't have ministry. She doesn't have money. She doesn't have loss. And in her mind, they're saying, this was very costly. In her mind, she goes, this is nothing. Look what is right here. Look at the heart in this guy. He is about to give himself selflessly for all of us. I heard it out of his mouth. Not that he didn't tell me he's a lamb. I just heard that spirit flowing. And I realized, oh my God, this guy, this being, this one, we're on the verge of him totally giving himself for us. She didn't understand the theology of atonement and all that stuff. She understood a nature. How do I put that in words? She understood her nature, and she's just like, she's moved, and she's wanting to do what she could, and she's there, and she's trying to communicate without words. She's trying to communicate, number one, I'm back. Number two, I see you, and I honor you with whatever I got. I pour it out on you, and I want you to know that I'm with you, and I want you to know that as you go into this, I am anointing you for what you have to do, because that's your spirit.
Hallelujah.
That's what I'm doing.
Praise God.
And he's going, I got it. You know, you can't miss that. And that spirit is, when it's real, you can't miss that. And he's going, I got it. And then the disciples speak up, the 12, the close ones, the great men of God. They're looking, what is this woman doing here? What's she going to do? What she can. She did what she could. What's she going to do? We've been with you 3.5 years. We serve you. We know what you're about. And this woman is actually doing things contrary to what we're trying to accomplish for you, Jesus. I wonder if Jesus said, let her alone. You know, probably with a British accent. Let her alone. She had done this for my burial. Oh, I just went into something else. I think he said, let her. I think that he's just going, oh my God, she's back. This is, and he just says, let her alone. This is important. This is eternally important. This is memorial ministry. This is the true thing of which in the Old Testament they would set up a memorial, or I would tell them, make a memorial. This is marking something eternal and not just temporal ministry. You know, it's not all temporal ministry, but it's temporal in that there's not going to be any sick in heaven. They're not going to be, you know, there's not going to be any demons running around in heaven. There's not going to be all this stuff that we're trying to chase out now. Let's get all of the demons out of Denton. That's still not eternal. Besides, if we got all the Dentons out of all the demons out of Denton, some of you wouldn't be here anymore. I'm just teasing. I'm teasing. Half the church would be gone. All right, so let's just read the last part of this. And I'd already flipped over here. Let's see. Looking for that other one. Boy, the Lord didn't want y'all to have what I had in this little book right here, but it's good. It really is good. I mean, it is good. And you know what? It was here before. I don't know when I wrote it, a long time ago, because I've written a bunch of stuff in here. It's the first page of this book. And I pulled it out just a few days ago and went, you know, and it's locked, sealed. Oh. He said no. But it had been written before we got into all of this. And I just went, wow, Lord, you're really something else. Anyway, we're in Mark 14, and this we'll just close with this. This is my first ending. Mark 14, verse 3. And being in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat eating, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment of spikenard, very precious. She broke the box and poured the ointment on his head. And there were some that had indignation within themselves. Indignation. Not, we don't get the idea that it's outward as much as with something that's in them. Does that bother anybody? That this would be in them. And said, why was this waste of the ointment made? For it might have been, it could have been, but now it's past. You messed up. It might have been sold for more than 300 denarii and have been given to the poor. And they murmured against her. And Jesus said, let her alone. See, that's immediate. Let her alone. Why trouble ye her? She hath wrought a good work on me. For ye have the poor with you always. She did this. She's done a good work. You and your ministry have the poor with you always. And whenever ye will, ye may do good, do them good. But me you have not always. She hath done what she could and is come beforehand to anoint my body for the burial. Verily I say unto you, wherever this gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial of her. And this is, the beauty of this is that the memorials that were set up in the Old Testament, just as this one, the beauty of it is in this, particularly in this case, this is like the Lord is everywhere this goes. It's like these rocks, you know, because that's how they did memorials back then. They do all these rocks. And everywhere this goes, there's going to be a pile of rocks that, to my heart, I know what that means. And there, and there, and there, everywhere. And maybe people go, what are these rocks? What's this about? See, you're going to get that. It's a memorial of her. Jesus has something that touched him so deeply that he's going to just memorialize this act and this woman in this heart everywhere. And so he's going to look from up there and he goes, it's there and 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 there. And
praise God.
Someone, and there is that, the beauty of that she first sat at his feet. And she drew out something that nobody else got in on. Then she messed up. Then she came back with a vengeance, if you understand what I mean.
Yes.
She came back even harder, which is the great story, if you want to be written into the great story. The great story isn't about how badly you brought Jesus to tears. The great story is that seeing that was enough to crush your little heart and to drive you to his feet and to his heart and to not just touch his feet or his head, but to touch his heart. And Jesus just says, this earth is going to be full with piles of stone. And every time I see it, That's how big it is to me.
Hallelujah.
Let's stand together and we'll pray. You know what? We already prayed for Jason, but Jason, would you come up here and we'll just pray for you too. And anybody that wants to come up and pray for him, he just got here and he's going to have to go back. And him and Shay, we'd already said this, but him and Shay are going to be driving back. It's a 5-day journey. It's like a 1-year journey by mule, isn't it? Anyway, it really is a rough thing. The roads, the things that you run into,
could be dangerous.
Dangerous. There are banditos and stuff like that, believe it or not, that are still out there. But it's going to go pretty quick because it's Jason and Shay. And they get along really well. And may the Lord fill that car, amen, with his presence and his sun flowing over them and out of them. And may it just be so precious. And may the time go by so quickly for them. Father, we just pray, first of all, for this journey. And we just ask you, Lord, to release your spirit upon them, Lord. Just protect them and guide them, Father. But more importantly, protect them so that they can just flow with you. And Lord, I know that all of it isn't meant to just be sharing and whatever. Lord, let them laugh. Let them have a good time. Let them relax. Lord, let them relax and be in a situation where they don't feel a bunch of pressure. Kind of put them in a bubble where they can just enjoy you and enjoy one another and enjoy music if necessary, whatever, Father. However you want to order it, we ask you to take care of them, Father. Yes. Father, we also know that there are many trials and situations that Jason has to face and deal with, and as a father and as a man of God and as missionaries, Nisi and their kids and then the new kids, Father, we just ask you to take care of them. We ask you to move by your spirit upon them in a special way. Move even greater than you have, Lord, but move in a special way and cover them and bless them and knit them together. And Lord, may this family grow up in you to such a manner that in years to come, these kids will be mighty tools for you and they will find your heart and they will reach places that Jason and Nisi could never reach, Father. Father, that the ongoing gospel would continue to go and that memorial would go rise up in every place, Father. Father, thank you. Thank you, Father. Lord, I just pray that you'll strengthen Jason and give him wisdom as head, Father, and you know that you'll give him everything that he needs to be able to speak and follow you and lead this family and to be a blessing to the people that are around them while they're there, Father. We thank you. And Father, we also pray that while he's here, whatever needs that they have, Lord, that you will take care of, Father. We know that this is an opportune time, that this is a time that you could actually pour finances into them or gifts of certain things that they might need. Father, and also because Shay, his situation with his job or lack of, and Father, that right now, for him to do this, Lord, he could actually use financial help, but he's laying down his life, and he's doing it for you and others and for the gospel. So, Father, just pray your blessings upon him. Take care of him and his family and his needs, Father. Thank you for his heart and his commitments to you, Lord, as he draws closer to you and wants to see more of your glory, not in him and in his family and as a covering. And Father, it's just in his heart to do that. And as all of us, he doesn't fully know how to do that and release everything, but he is open to you and wants you. So Lord, take care of these two men and their families and bring glory to your son by the things that you do in their lives and by the things that you do for their families. Father, we ask it in Jesus' name. Lord, we ask you for us, the sharing of the word here today, let it sink into our being. Let us become more and more and more and more and more and more and more separated, hearts unto you, Jesus, so that when we do take the gospel around the world, when we do compassionate ministry, it will be marked by memorial ministry that first took place and was separated unto for enough time to get it established. Father, thank you. Bless us with your Son more and more as we contemplate him. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're dismissed.